Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Immersive Medical Podcast. I'm Devin Marble from the Immersive Medical YouTube channel.
And I'm Connor Bradalich, regular guy.
This is a regular guy. This is a think tank at the cross-section of healthcare and immersive solutions. We love you, Connor. Strap in, because today we're excited to have Paul Mazurek coming to us from inside the cabin of his med evac helicopter. I wonder, he's on shift. Will he get a call in the middle of the pod recording?
I remember we were worried about the recording schedule specifically for this reason.
Yeah.
Paul is a critical care nurse, flight nurse, certified healthcare simulation educator, a nationally certified paramedic, and has a master's of education. Needless to say, he's got a lot of letters after his name. He also teaches at community colleges and universities in Michigan and is a product manager at VR Patients, where he creates virtual reality nursing simulations that help students around the world.
Talk about someone who's working to make an impact in healthcare. He works the front line, he teaches the front line, and deploys immersive solutions to the front line.
We're so excited to hear from him, so let's jump right in.
Without further ado, we are pleased to introduce to you Paul Mazurek.
Is that CCR?
Heck yeah, man. He's in a helicopter. We got to. Let's go. And welcome, Paul Mazurek, flight nurse out in Michigan. How are you doing today, sir? Thank you for joining us on the Immersive Medical Show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. So before we get into this, can you tell us a little bit about your background? Like, how'd you become a flight nurse? Or why? Why did you become a flight nurse? It's probably more accurate. How? I went to school. Why?
That's an even better question. Well, I started out as a paramedic. So I was a paramedic in upstate New York for a number of years. And a lot of the paramedics that I worked with actually worked as nurses, and they introduced me to the profession and got me got my juices flowing a little bit. And so I, instead of moving down the EMS path, I kind of veered off a little bit, took a left-hand turn, and went to nursing school. So as a nurse, I still really liked the being out and about. I didn't really like being confined to a particular unit or a particular area of the hospital. So, and I really enjoy the moving the patients around kind of aspect. So yeah, this fit very well for me.
That's pretty cool, man.
He's an adrenaline junkie.
He's an adrenaline junkie.
Not so much anymore, but back then, yeah.
So do you still get an adrenaline rush or excitement when you get a call?
When the tones go off, I still, you still feel the heart rate kind of going up a little bit and kind of try to calm yourself down. It all just depends on what the information is when the radio goes off.
Well, look, we're really excited to interview you and ask you some very difficult questions for our listeners, many of which may want to become a flight nurse and be just like you when they grow up. But before we do, if you're not watching this on the Immersive Medical YouTube channel, you're going to miss out right now. So consider popping over and taking a peek. Paul, can you explain to us and show us where you're sitting right now? Because this is not a normal interview where you're just at your desk.
So right now I'm in the cockpit of one of our rotor wing aircraft, our helicopters. It's a EC-155 made by Airbus. It's actually quite a, for air medical transport, it's quite a spacious helicopter. So I'll just kind of see if I can gently take you around a little bit. So I'm sitting in one of the seats. We've got three seats back here, and you can see that's our ventilator. And as I kind of, that's out there. We're in the hangar right now. So that's our jet.
Wow.
It's a Lear 75.
Can you point it down just a little bit more so we can see? There you go. Wow. A big old blue and yellow jet. University of Michigan right across the side of it.
Yeah,
it
fits with the team colors.
Yeah. So, and are those pumps over there, like infusion pumps? You got three?
Yes. So we stock three in our aircraft. If we need more, we have more. So we can certainly take as many as our patient that we're going to pick up needs. And this is where the patient lies. I apologize that it's a little messy right now, but this is some of the equipment that we keep on the stretcher that obviously comes off when the patients loaded onto the stretcher, and we've got our monitor. So,
wow. So I've always wondered this, when you land and you're, you know, when you go on a call, something is really wrong, right? Or someone's really rural, they're really far away, but presuming that they're not calling you just because they're far away, people have called the flight crew because the ground crew can't handle what's going on and they're not fast enough. They need a helicopter, right?
Most of the time, yeah.
So generally speaking, are your calls high acuity, very, very, very sick patients, or are they just also very, very far away from definitive care?
It's kind of a mixture of both. We're in an area of Michigan where we can certainly make it to most areas of our state by helicopter within about an hour or so. Otherwise, you know, obviously we'll take our jet. So if we go to the upper peninsula of our state, a lot of times we'll take the jet. If we're going far away, like to other states, we'll take our jet. Most of our transports are fairly high acuity. So it's one of those situations that, you know, we have a, we have a scope of practice that's a little bit beyond what a typical ground ambulance might have. We're trained as obviously we're nurses. We're also paramedics. So as a nurse, we bring critical care, intensive care experience, pediatric intensive care experience, things typically ground crews don't get as part of their training or experience. So it depends if the patient needs to come to the university or if they need to come to another very large hospital and they're far away. A lot of times we'll call to take those people out, or if it's something that maybe is a little bit too much for an ALS service to maybe handle.
Gotcha. Paul, I don't remember if I already asked you why you became a nurse. Did we already go over that one?
I think I became a nurse because when I was working as a paramedic, I got a lot of exposure to nurses and the different areas that nurses practiced. And I didn't really know what nurses did, but I was exposed to emergency rooms, intensive care units. I shadowed a certified registered nurse anesthetist, CRNA, in the operating room. I shadowed a flight nurse, and it seemed like there was just a lot of opportunity for nurses, depending on what you wanted to do. Now, there's a lot of opportunities for nurses that don't involve blood and, you know, critical people dying all the time. There's plenty of opportunities out there. Nursing is a really good area of healthcare because there's a need for nurses almost in every aspect of healthcare. So it's a really good profession.
It's definitely an industry that's always going to be there.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm never without a job.
We're not going to have ChatGPT taking over bedside nursing. That's for sure.
Yeah, not yet.
Yeah. Okay, so here's a question for you. So what would you say to someone who wants to be like you when they grow up? Like, would you recommend it? Are you saying, yes, be a flight nurse, it's amazing? Or, hey, kids, maybe don't be a flight nurse. So what would you recommend to someone who wants to be like you?
Well, I've been a flight nurse for 20 years, and I'm ready to start looking to greener pastures. So I certainly would welcome anybody to come take my job, for sure. But yeah, I think depending on what it is that you're looking to do, to become a flight nurse, you typically have to work in a variety of areas. Intensive care, emergency department. Most of our nurses, probably 80% of our nurses have pediatric intensive care unit backgrounds. All of our nurses are also dual licensed as paramedics. There are some air medical programs that operate with a nurse and a paramedic, which is nice because you have both of those roles still covered. We choose to have our nurses dual license for the simple fact that most of the stuff that we do is intensive care unit heavy technology type stuff like balloon pumps and ventricular assist devices and advanced ventilatory strategies and things like that. So in order to operate in the state of Michigan as an ambulance, you have to have a paramedic on board every call. So we just kind of took care of all of that by requiring that our nurses become paramedics as well. For somebody who's thinking about wanting to become a flight nurse, I definitely, probably the most impactful or most important skill that you can come out of nursing school with is clinical reasoning. And any nursing student right now is understanding that and learning that, you know, just to make it through your NCLEX exam, they're going to assess a lot of the stuff that they're going to assess has to do with clinical reasoning, clinical judgment, problem solving. So coming out of school and then developing that wherever you decide to work is going to really help you when you decide you want to come do our job, because most of the time we don't have somebody looking over our shoulder. We rarely have anybody, you know, providing orders for us to do anything. We do operate under a set of protocols, but there are times where the protocols don't fit and we have to make decisions on our own. And in order to do that, you have to start kind of fostering that sooner than later.
All right, before we go any further, I want to give a shout out to our friends at VR Patients. VR Patients is bringing the future of medical education to you with the world's first virtual reality simulation authoring tool. These guys have turned medical training into a fully immersive experience. Just imagine, it's like strapping on your VR headset and diving into the exact scenario you need for your students. It's as if you're shaping their educational journeys in real time. Pretty cool, huh? And let me tell you, their grading rubric is as objective as it gets, which means no guesswork, no bias, just accurate, constructive feedback. Head on over to VRPatients.com. That's VRPatients.com and get the lowdown on this game-changing platform.
So you brought up something right now that I kind of want to touch on. So I have heard clinical reasoning, clinical competency, good decision-making skills, but that's different than having IV skills or medication administration skills, right? Or bedside manner even. So can you give me an example? When you mean clinical reasoning, can you give me an example maybe of a time in the field where you were with a real patient and you had to utilize that skill?
Well, walking into a room, for instance, one time we walked into a room and the physician who was a family practice physician, we were at a small community critical access hospital, and the physician insisted that the patient needed an airway. He wasn't necessarily comfortable, but he wanted us to do it before we left. And I looked up at the monitor, and the patient had a heart rate of 36. So I said, that seems slow. And so we started doing our quick assessment and realized that the patient had an altered level of consciousness because the patient was bradycardic and didn't have much in the way of cardiac output. So after we attempted to increase the heart rate, we used some medicine and it eventually put some transcutaneous pacing pads on the patient and got their heart rate up. The patient immediately woke up, started screaming and, you know, using expletives. And we got her calmed down, got her settled down a little bit. And it turned out that the patient didn't need to be intubated. The patient just needed a faster heart rate.
You woke her up. You gave her some caffeine.
So it was just one of those things that, and she did, she had a cardiac rhythm that required a permanent pacemaker. Once we finally got her to the destination,
sure,
that's exactly what she got. But it was one of those instances where had we just provided neuromuscular blockade and provided sedation to intubate her, we may have killed her. We may have dumped her blood pressure even further down. And she may have died as a result by just doing that one procedure that arguably she probably needed if, you know, she's not able to protect her own airway. But, you know, we thought maybe that she needed a faster heart rate, which could give her more cardiac output, which could then provide her with a little bit more perfusion to her brain, which would then wake her up a little bit. So that's that's a simple example of a time where we've really had to, you know, put our thinking caps on a little bit.
Right. Just critical problem solving.
Yeah. You know, you made me think of the saying that we always use in EMS is BLS before ALS, but that's on like level two, because that's still ALS before advanced ALS, right? That's ALS before critical care, which is very interesting. And it's super important too, because you might find that it's a completely different source problem. So she may absolutely need an airway if you start to give her succinylcholine and she's paralyzed and now her heart rate tanks and now her blood pressure tanks. And you're like, well, maybe we shouldn't have gone down this path because now we're stuck. Now we have to be here.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, and it's just a different set of tools in your tool bag. You know, I tell paramedics this all the time because I teach critical care courses at, you know, in the area. And I tell paramedics this all the time. It's just a matter of, you know, when you were an EMT, you got out of EMT school with a certain set of tools. And then you went to paramedic school and then you got another little few more tools in your toolbox. And now you're talking about doing critical care transport. And there's a lot of stuff that is involved in taking care of critically ill patients, but you come with a lot of tools already that you can utilize easily. But then also we provide a few other tools that, you know, maybe you didn't have access to allow you to do your job a little bit easier.
Yeah, absolutely. So let me ask you, let me shift gears here a little bit. I want to ask you about healthcare in general, because people who want to grow up and be just like you one day, they're entering a field. We all know that healthcare, the field of healthcare and frontline medicine, we can call it, right? Where you're the one who picks up the phone on 911 and I'm on my way to save the day for you. It's not just about the long-term care that you might receive in a hospital or family practice, right? So this emergent care, it's facing a lot of problems. We've got a 30%, I think the numbers are 30% deficit of nurses and even EMS professionals. And then we have a deficit of students. And then we have issues with trying to produce more students, better students faster. And certainly these ChatGPTs are mucking up the works and not making anything easier for the colleges. Everyone's just asking chat for the answers. So my question for you is, what are some problems facing healthcare today, some challenges that you would like to solve if you could? Like if you could wave a magic wand, what's something you'd like to tackle? If maybe you are already tackling some problems facing healthcare.
Well, you know, that's a really good question. I think off the top of my head, there's a twofold answer to this question for me. I remember when I first started in healthcare, I remember it being a little bit more collegial. I remember there being a lot more teamwork involved. And
that's interesting.
I think that in today's age where, you know, we live in an Amazon culture where, you know, you decide you want something, you go to Amazon, you order it, and it's at your doorstep the next day or sooner.
Yeah.
And so people are very... It's a little bit different culture as far as wanting something and wanting it now. there's a lot of healthcare and becoming good at healthcare takes a lot of work and it takes a lot of time and there's a lot of frustration to it. And with the good comes the bad. I think that people get discouraged very easily. The other thing that I feel is that, and COVID may have had something to do with this as well, just because we were so inundated with people. It was just, we were bursting at the seams and it was just every area of the hospital. You could feel it. It was palpable. It's so tough to just come in and work and you'd finish up your shift and all you wanted to do was cry or have a stiff drink. And everybody kind of just, you know, kind of went into their own little silo. And right. Now it just seems like the nurses that are coming out of nursing school and the nurses that are progressing to ICUs and other areas of healthcare, they're used to just having a physician or a care provider just tell them what to do. So they've become very task-oriented. they've not really, it's hard for them to really figure out how to solve problems when they don't have practice at it, or they're not asked to do that.
And you just described that as a key skill, if you want to be like you when you grow up, is clinical judgment.
And I think that, you know, one of the things that just absolutely cracks me up is when I go to some of these simulation conferences, or we have a discussion, you know, regarding how people train, and everybody talks about this buzzword, which is IPE, interprofessional education, like collaborative education. And this is what we do, and we bring doctors and nurses together and train and all that stuff. But somehow it's not translating from the classroom to the hospital. And I probably am not speaking for everybody, but I'm only speaking from my own experience, where I feel that the different disciplines in healthcare are now kind of in survival mode, where they're just kind of thinking of themselves and they're in silos. And it's very hard at times to really feel, you know, what can we do as a team? Now, you know, and of course, there are examples that speak contrary to what I've been talking about all over the place. And I think it's great. I mean, there's a lot of times where it's just absolutely refreshing when I get to the bedside of a really sick patient, and the respiratory therapist, the physician, the nurses, everybody, we walk in, they welcome us as part of that team.
Yeah.
We all work together. We stabilize the patient. We get the patient out the door. That is refreshing. It used to happen in my experience. It used to happen almost every call that I was on. And now it's just not as frequent, and it's sad. That's something, if you want, you know, if it's like one thing that I could change, I would figure out how to create more of a collegial environment in healthcare between all of our disciplines, because it's, you know, the evidence doesn't lie. When we work as a team, patient outcomes improve.
I bet.
Well, that was a lot to unpack. Thank you for that. And I think that you're hitting the nail on the head with a lot of stuff, because just in my own experience, like, we'll say right for now, my grandparents, for example, are facing a lot of new medical issues as they age into this next decade of their life. And there's so much disjoint communication between all of her healthcare providers. And I know that that's a little bit different than maybe all the healthcare providers you might face just in the emergency room when you walk in. But for example, my grandmother, she had to go into the emergency room because she had an issue and it required emergent intervention. She had some fluid in her lungs, and there was not as much communication as we would have hoped for. What meds are you already taking before we put more meds in your system, so we understand what might happen, because there are interactions. And then there's also the discharge and the prescription and a misunderstanding of, am I supposed to take this on top of my existing meds? But there wasn't exactly the care team to kind of sit down and go through those questions with her. And as a paramedic, I was able to kind of intervene and ask those challenging questions. And it's very interesting.
Or even know to ask those questions.
Yeah. My family talks a lot.
Yeah. Because if you're talking to any like layman, I mean, I wouldn't know to ask like what questions to ask, or, you know, are these two pills going to interact with each other? I feel like everyone needs a Devin, or everyone needs, you know, someone in the family that kind of knows.
Everyone needs a Paul around this. Everyone needs a Paul.
Yeah, for sure.
It's definitely very interesting. And honestly, it sometimes makes me wonder how some of these AI chatbots are going to change healthcare and medicine, how technology is changing healthcare and medicine. My hope is that it's positive. And so now when people are, now that this AI bot is integrated into Bing and versus Google, I actually did an experiment with this where on one end, you may search something that's typical. My toddler's 3-year-olds, they have a fever and they have no signs and symptoms. What does this mean? What do I do? I'm a new parent. And then Google produces, you know, a list of results that you have to sift through to find the answer. Their blogs, their articles, a lot of them are sponsored ads. But chat and Bing, the combo, they just give you the answer. And then it's empathetic and it tells you, don't be worried. You know, here's some things to consider. And if you're still worried after I tell you these things, go consult your physician. And then it gives references, but they're not ads. It's a whole different way for the consumer or the civilian person who is not a medical person to perhaps have a little bit, be armed a little more information and context about medicine and healthcare and how it might impact them before and after they go in and out of a healthcare situation. That actually kind of leads me to another question, Paul. How has technology impacted you as a flight nurse? Has it been positive? Are your pumps getting smaller? Is everything getting faster? Your screens looking cooler? Your airplanes getting faster?
All of the above. Technology is amazing. From the ventilator,
that's awesome to hear.
From the ventilator that we use, I mean, we now have very similar modes of ventilation that we're able to use compared to an ICU ventilator. The pumps are smaller. They're easier to operate. The different types of assist devices are much easier to use. When I first started, I remember having to time balloon pumps manually with little dials on each side for inflation and deflation time. And now now the balloon pump automatically times because it senses the pressure right at the aortic root. And
wow,
I don't have to do anything except move the patient on a pump. So technology is definitely our best friend.
That is super refreshing to hear, because of all the challenges that are facing healthcare, it does sound like at least the ones we brought up today have to do with humans and our ability to come together and join hands and push forward together. And technology, so far in this conversation, there will be others where technology will be a part of the problem.
Yeah.
But today, it's there as an asset to help us along and make us run faster, train faster, be bigger, faster, stronger. That is very encouraging for healthcare, I think.
Absolutely.
Okay, let's talk VR patients. Now, these folks, they're not just creating a VR platform. They're revolutionizing medical training. So picture this. You're anywhere in the world, and you just log onto a VR patient's account, strap on your VR headset, or pull up your web browser, and boom, you're in the middle of a high-stakes medical scenario. Sounds like sci-fi, right? But it's as real as it gets. It's like having a futuristic healthcare classroom right in your pocket. Check it out for yourself at vrpatients.com. That's vrpatients.com. Trust me, it's worth a look. Okay, so I want to ask you about some patients. Can we get into some nitty gritty? Can you tell us a story? If not, I got some stories that I can tell, but I want to hear from you. What is a patient that you had that just really stuck with you? I mean, it can be a patient that you lost that's why maybe you still remember it. But I'm curious, what has stuck with you, even positive, negative? I don't know. This audience can handle it.
Well, I think for me, and I'm not a parent, but any time that a little kid is really sick and they're dying. It's very hard. It's very hard to deal with. I've been placed in situations before where, the physician couldn't, bring themselves to tell the parents what's going on. So I've had to have that difficult conversation. There've been times where, you walk in and 1 minute the child seems fine and you're ready to put the kid on the stretcher. And then all of a sudden you look up at the monitor and their heart rate's 40. They're, pulling kids out of, cars and ditches and, having to tell, siblings, why, a child, their brother or sister isn't going to be able to make it to Christmas. Those are all the things that really stick with me that really, to be honest with you, suck. And just make me really question whether or not, that times, am I doing the right thing? Am I in the right position? Was there something more that I could do? And, what can I learn from this? What can I glean from this? And sometimes there's nothing really that can be identified. And there are other times where, definitely it's like in this situation, the next time, and there will be a next time, this is how I'm going to do it, and this is why. Those are always really good learning experiences for me.
You know, you're touching on something that simulation might actually be able to impact on. And that is this idea of trying again, right? This idea of sometimes they're called halos, high acuity, low occurrence, high, you know, low frequency, high risk. But these patients that you get that are really tough, that stick with you, I just want to ask you personally, from your perspective, if you could try again in a simulated environment on one of those challenging patients, how would you think that would impact you as a professional?
I think that it would either confirm or maybe teach me something that maybe I missed. So given a second chance, and saying, hey, I've learned from my mistake. Did I really learn from my mistake? Let's see if I have. I know that I've done that to, you know, as clinical educator, I've done that to the flight nurses that I train a lot. We actually do that quite a bit, where we'll put them through most of the scenarios that I've written, and most of the scenarios that I run them through have been actual calls that we've had over the years.
Sure.
And it allows, it's kind of nice because it allows a different perspective for maybe the flight nurse that was actually on the call to see how somebody else would have done it. And it also allows somebody to gain experience that maybe they will not have gained during their initial training. And it allows us to, depending on how you run it, it allows us to stop and course correct, or it allows us to, you know, let them totally obliterate the scenario. So then we can rewind it, reboot, and go back in and do it again. And it increases their, I think it increases confidence while the learning is taking place. So it's, you know, it also provides a level of scaffolding, where if you're trying to bring across, or if you're trying to put across a certain tacit learning point, you know, as they gain that, then they're able to kind of build off of that and increase their knowledge and their skill based on one particular scenario. So you could cover multiple objectives in one type of scenario by running it over and over again.
Nice. Well, I think what you just described initially can feel pretty somber and a bummer.
Yeah.
But it's actually extremely hopeful, because there's this opportunity as well to train on something that is intentionally a no-win situation. And that's because this is the field we're in, folks, right? If you're looking to become just like Paul one day, then, you know, there's a certain level of thick skin that we all have to form. And sometimes we think we've got it before we do. And then you have that patient that tests it. And when that happens, you either come out the other end looking to improve because of that situation, or you come out the other end really questioning, why did I enter this field? There is definitely an in-between in there. And I think the reason why I'm talking about this is because mental health is such an important aspect of joining this career field. I mean, in EMS, we do, and maybe it's called something different in the hospital, but critical stress debriefs. You know, if you have, because these firefighters who are also paramedics are running into burning buildings, dealing with the worst of the worst, they have to do it over again, over again, over and over. Just like the football player who dropped on the field from Komodo Cordis, and everyone was very moved, and some people painfully moved in a negative way by watching the CPR happen on television. But people also need to remember that those EMTs and paramedics, they had to go out on another call. That was actually a standard call, right?
That's every day for them.
Yes. That is BLS. That is push hard and push fast and get the AED on them. This is typical. Those EMS professionals probably had three or four more calls, and one of them guaranteed was worse than that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I just want to make sure we're thinking about their mental health as well, because unfortunately there's a little bit of a stigma around doing your critical stress debrief, right? And I don't want to go talk to a therapist and then get pulled out of duty because my mental health is feeling a little bit injured right now. I have to be there for my brothers and sisters who we work as a team. And you put on a face, a facade. And I sometimes wonder how simulation can help with that, because I envision this hopeful environment where where someone who has a difficult call then simulates that difficult call, then trains their department or their educators, their coworkers on that call. And now it's read it, write it, teach it, right? You get to experience it, then you get to teach people about it. And I think there's a certain amount of catharsis that happens from that. What do you think, Paul?
I think that, when it comes to, this I guess, nebulous term at times, critical thinking or reasoning or things like that comes with time and experience. And so it's one of those things where, and it also comes with having a support system. I remember as I was going up, as I was moving through my experience as a paramedic, when I was moving through my experiences as a nurse, there was always more than several people that I could lean on. There were more than several people that I could glean experience from. And there were more than several people that if I did something that was not to standard or just plain dumb, somebody let me know about it. And that's how I learned. So the time and the experience, and again, going back to that Amazon, mentality, a lot of times it's one of those instances where, we just don't have the time for that right now because we have all of this other stuff to do that are priorities. And if you're not investing the time into the people that, eventually are going to be taking care of you or are going to be the people that have been, through the ringers, and I just don't see that system. I don't see that system sustaining itself.
Sure. Paul, we're getting a little bit short on time here because this has been such a fascinating conversation with you. So I really, really appreciate your time on shift, no less. a small part of me was hoping you were going to get a call in the middle of this interview and we were going to see you when you came back. So I think we're going to finish up with some lightning questions we have for you. And Connor and I will just go back and forth and ask you some questions and just answer them off the top of your head. And we'll see how it goes. Are you ready for the lightning round?
We'll try.
Okay. What's your favorite color?
Blue.
What's your favorite way to unwind after work?
TikTok.
TikTok.
All right.
That was diplomacy right there.
Oh.
I'm not going to say I have a whiskey. We're going to go with TikTok.
scrolling down the wormhole.
All right.
Just
I
getting
like
lost.
It.
Yeah.
I've learned how to cook so many different foods. It's amazing.
You're funny.
Yeah.
Have you cooked any new foods?
I have.
Or do you just know how to cook new foods?
Oh, I made this Mississippi pot roast, this pork belly Pete or pot belly Pete. Oh my gosh. He is amazing.
What? Is that your favorite? What's your favorite type of video in your TikTok feed?
Oh, the
cooking ones?
Well, there's also the nostalgic music like from the 80s and 70s.
Yeah.
I love like the MTV generation. Those are my favorite.
Yeah. And you see like the young like Xennials like not knowing what the song is and it's like 99 Red Balloons and you're like, what are you talking about? You don't know that song.
I have no idea what you guys are talking about right now.
See if you see if you can name this song in two beats.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. Yep. All right. So I think it's on me now. What's your favorite book?
Red Storm Rising by Tom Clancy.
Nice. I like it.
Have to check that one out. What is your, if you could have a superpower, what would you choose?
Oh, wow. I'd really like to be really, really fast, like the Flash. He was my favorite superhero.
The Flash? I thought for sure you were going to say flight because you're a flight nurse. It just seemed like a shoe-in.
Yeah.
But I guess you get to fly all the time, right? So you already have that superpower.
Yeah.
We're very thankful that you're the one flying to save us all. So thank you for that. Let's see here. Where would you travel, given the opportunity?
Australia.
On the planet.
Australia.
What time of year?
Doesn't matter.
It's pretty hot down there.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter. All right.
It's always hot.
Giant spiders and kangaroos. Let's do it.
Yep.
Paul, if you could go to dinner with any historical figure, who would you choose?
Oh, Abraham Lincoln.
Amen. Oh, dang it. Every guest better not say that one because that's a good
right.
one. Do you have any pets?
My wife has one dog.
My wife has one dog.
It's a really small dog, and anytime she's around, he follows her. He follows her all over the place. It is not my dog. If I were to have a dog,
that's right.
If I were to have a dog, it would be a husky.
Oh, nice.
High energy dogs,
though. Yeah, they jump. They're big jumpers.
Gorgeous, though.
Yeah.
Gorgeous dogs. Blue eyes. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Coffee or tea?
Coffee. Coffee with a lot of stuff in
absolutely.
It.
Absolutely. Come on. He's a healthcare worker.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, man. We'll just end that. Let's go to the next one.
Yeah.
If you could travel to any time period, where would you go? Or when would you go, I guess?
Ooh. Nice.
I would probably get killed, but I always wanted to, like, the time period around when the Vikings from Scandinavia were kind of taking over most of Europe. I'm really into Vikings.
Yes, 100%. Like, you're going to the time period where you're going to drink out of a horn. The only food that you eat is out of a wooden bowl. It's a sloppy something, and you don't have spoons. You just use the bread, and you dip it into it, and that's how you eat in front of a fire.
Yep.
100%. Good choice.
Now, I know we fantasize that lifestyle a lot, but yeah, Vikings are rad as hell.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I would.
I went to Iceland, and I got to eat with these farmers, and they were all enormous people. Like, at least to me, I'm only 5'7", so they were all just towering over me. And they all had fresh lamb coats, like wool, like over their shoulders from their farm. And we were in a giant teepee in a fire, and it was freezing out. And this is exactly what it was like. It was like fresh meat, fresh bowl of slop and bread, like no utensils. And we're all sitting around a fire just gorging. And I'm like, this is what history is like. 100%. Yeah. I would go there with you, Paul. Oh, favorite sports team. But let's go. I don't think we can go college sports team because we know the answer. You got a big giant yellow M behind you. So favorite professional sports team.
And again, if you don't say a Michigan team, I think we might need to keep this interview in the vault.
No. Well, I grew up on the west side of our state. So most of my professional sports teams are from Chicago. So I'm a Bears, Blackhawks, and White Sox fan.
Not the Bulls?
Yeah, I'm not a big basketball guy.
Okay, I could see that. All right.
As a Packers fan, we can't be friends anymore.
Uh-oh.
I understand. Well, we still suck, so.
Yeah, we're not doing all that.
Well, let's be honest. Saying that any professional sports team sucks, they're still the best athletes on the planet. I can't play on the field with them.
I would not be able to compete with them in any aspect.
Hey, if I'm paying that kind of money to go watch you, you better be good.
That's right. That's right. And if I'm making that EMS call, you better be good. Because that flight's going to be expensive.
Exactly.
All right, last question. Go for it.
I know that we've talked about how much you love your job right now, but if you could choose any other job, what would you choose?
I would love to learn how to build video games.
Oh, game developer.
I'm going to introduce you to my cousin then. That's what he does.
That is a hot industry right now.
I would absolutely.
Hot industry for a decade.
Yeah. I would love to learn that.
So then are you a gamer?
Not really. In my graduate work, so I have a graduate degree in educational technology, and one of the part of my track had to do with game design and development, which I absolutely loved. But my professor told me, it's like, you know, we have a degree program for this, but I don't think you'd be very good at it. And I was like, why is that? And she's like, do you ever play games? I mean, you're a really good student, but you know, you've got to immerse yourself in what you're doing. I mean, you know, you need to play games. So for graduation, my wife got me an Xbox. So I got Madden. I got pretty good at Madden, and I got pretty good at the NHL game.
Right into sports again
as well.
Yeah.
Very good. Hey, yeah, Connor, the con man, he's a hockey player.
Oh, really? Oh, I love hockey.
NHL absolutely since 2000. Yep.
Yeah, absolutely love hockey.
That's awesome.
Best sport on earth, in my opinion.
Yep.
All right, guys. Paul, thank you so much for your time today. It was incredible having you on the Immersive Medical Podcast. I just want to close with one more question, which is, do you have any advice for that new budding hopeful student, new grad, medic who's thinking about becoming a flight nurse, someone who wants to be like you when they grow up? Any advice for them?
If you stick with it, it will happen. I promise you. Give me a call. We are hiring right now. Please, you know, it don't get discouraged. Stick with it. It will happen. It's a long road, but it's definitely worth it.
Thank you. I think that's perfect final words. We'll put any notes that Paul wants people to know where you can find him in the show notes. And Paul, thank you so much for your time today.
Thanks for having me. This was great.
Awesome.
Yeah, we really appreciate you coming on.
Okay. Thank you so much. Take care.
Take care. Hey, Connor, are you finding it challenging to organize asynchronous clinical education for all your students?
Devin, I don't have any students.
Well, that's okay, because no matter the class size, from 10 to 10,000 students, we have the perfect solution for you.
VR Patients isn't just a virtual reality platform. It's an asynchronous learning tool, which means students can access it anywhere, anytime.
Exactly. They can jump into a VR simulation from their VR headset or even from their web browser. Clinical competency training doesn't have to be confined to a specific schedule or location anymore.
To learn more about how VR Patients can make learning more accessible and scalable, head over to VRPatients.com. That's VRPatients.com.
And if you don't have any students just like Connor, but you do have a VR headset, you can try it right now for free on the MetaQuest Store or Steam.